Hello viewers and welcome back to You Forensic. In our last video, we discussed about the role of forensic science in criminal justice system. Today, we'll discuss about introduction to crime scene and fundamental laws of forensic science. To start with, let us first understand what is a crime scene. Any place where a crime was committed is a crime scene, and any object present at the crime scene, which might be very ordinary before commission of crime, is a crucial piece of evidence. It can be a house, a road, or even a vehicle. The most important issue with crime scene investigation is that even the slightest of action, maybe moving an object or even merely touching it, might result in loss of evidence, such as fingerprints or blood spatter evidence. The goal of a crime scene investigation is to recognize, document, and collect evidence at the scene of a crime. Solving the crime depends on piecing together all the evidence to reconstruct the crime scene. Now, moving forward to understand the type of crime scene. On the basis of location, crime scenes can be designated into primary and secondary crime scenes. For example, if a person was killed in a house and the body was later dragged and dumped in a forest, then the house becomes the primary crime scene, while the forest where the body was discovered is the secondary crime scene. The crime scenes can be macroscopic or microscopic. As the name indicates, microscopic crime scenes are small and exist within a macroscopic crime scene. For example, if a person is killed in a room, the room is a macroscopic crime scene, and the body, wounds on the body, etc. are microscopic crime scenes based on crime committed, that is, whether it is a case of homicide, robbery, sexual assault, etc. Based on physical location of the crime scene, they can be categorized as indoor, outdoor, vehicular, or underwater crime scenes. The type of evidence usually encountered at the crime scene, they are: number 1, direct evidence. This includes first-hand observations such as eyewitness accounts or police dashboard video cameras. Number 2 is circumstantial evidence. These are the indirect evidence that can be used to imply a fact but does not directly prove it. For example, finding a person's gun at the site of shooting is a circumstantial evidence that indicates towards the suspect's presence there. Further, circumstantial evidence can be either physical or biological in nature. Physical evidence includes impressions such as fingerprints, footprints, shoe prints, tire impressions, and tool marks. Physical evidence also includes fibers, weapons, bullets, and shell casings. Physical evidence, with the exception of fingerprints, reduces the number of suspects to a specific smaller group of individuals. Coming to biological evidence, this includes body fluids, hair, plant parts, and natural fibers. Biological evidence may make this group of suspects very small or even reduce it to a likely individual, which is more persuasive in court. Number 3 is trace evidence. It is a type of circumstantial evidence, examples of which include hairs found on a brush, fingerprints on a glass, blood drops on a shirt, soil tracked into a house from shoes, etc. Talking about the laws of forensic science, there are 6 basic laws which are mandatory for an appropriate crime scene investigation. Number 1 is law of individuality. This states that no two things in the universe are exactly the same. For example, fingerprints of 2 fingers, even of the same individual, are different. Number 2 is law of mutual exchange. This law was given by French scientist Edmond Locard. It states that whenever 2 things come in contact, they leave traces. For example, if the criminal breaks a window or a door using any instrument, it leaves its marks on the door frame. Also, the fragments of paint or wood get transferred to the instrument or to the clothes of the culprit. Number 3 is law of progressive change. This law states that nothing is permanent, unchangeable, or invariable. It describes that the scene of crime is always changing with time. Therefore, more the delay in examining the crime scene, the greater will be the loss to the crime scene and potential evidence present over there. For example, if a crime took place in an open environment, The potential evidence may get damaged during rain if not collected in time. Number 4 is law of analysis. The analysis can be no better than the samples analyzed. This law highlights the importance and necessity of proper sampling and packaging of evidentiary items for the effective and worthwhile results. Number 5 is law of probability. All identifications, definite or indefinite, are made consciously or unconsciously on the basis of probability. Probability is a mathematical concept which explains the chances of occurrence of a particular event. Number 6 is the law of circumstantial facts. This law states that facts cannot be modified, whereas the materialistic evidence or oral evidence can be modified, as the witnesses may turn hostile during the trial under any kind of pressure, and the materialistic evidence can be implanted or manipulated.